1932, the midwife who delivered him declared, "He's a perfect little Peterkin," after the children's dolls of the same name, which were all the rage in the 1920s and 30s. Well, the nickname stuck, and for the rest of his life, everybody knew Roger simply as Peter. How many of us here today knew that Peter was not his real name? We all knew Peter as a husband and a father, an organ builder and organ tragic, an orchestra roadie, a tinker and fixer-upper, a lovable curmudgeon with a sense of humour as dry as flint. Peter died in Newcastle on the 29th of April this year. He didn't want a funeral, but I'm sure that he would be very happy to know that so many of us have come together today to remember him through the thing which gave him the most pleasure in life, music. And we're lucky that Peter's spirit is with us today in the form of the grand organ behind me, which Peter built in 1973, and which lies at the heart of today's musical tributes. Today's opening tribute was given by James Goldrick, who played Maurice Duvernay's arrangement of Charles Tournemire's Improvisation sur le Te Deum. Our second performance today will be by Keith Asboe, playing Ralph Vaughan Williams' Prelude on Rosemead, followed by Jill Carter singing Richard Strauss's I'm Schlafen Gern from the Four Last Songs, accompanied by Thomas Wilson. But before we get underway, Keith, can I invite you to say a few words, please? Please make you welcome.
Craftsman's art and music's pleasure for thy pleasure.
Pogson, Peter to all of us, was born to Ruth and Herbert Pogson on the 25th of July, a week from now, in 1932, a brother to Enid, Audrey, Dorothy and John. He grew up in the Sydney suburb of Pennant Hills when it was little more than a village. He knocked around with the local lads on their motorbikes, and he loved his first car, which was a Morris Minor. Never one to bow to authority, Peter didn't enjoy school much, and only lasted one day in the Boy Scouts. After gaining his intermediate certificate at Hornsby Technical College, he left school to learn a trade, in this case bricklaying. Boredom set in early, however, and he abandoned that career. Peter's father played the organ at church, and Peter became interested in the mechanics of that instrument. This led him to an apprenticeship with ST Node and Sons, a company which built, tuned, and maintained a huge number of organs in New South Wales. In 1955, Peter married Barbara Kingsley at the tender age of 23. They had three children, Michael, Carey, and Leonie, in quick succession, and Peter built two houses for his young family. At the Nodes workshop, much of Peter's work involved modernising old organs, replacing the old mechanical action with an electric one. He became quite disenchanted with this line of work and felt it was time he branched out on his own, doing work that inspired him. This inspiration led early on to the construction of the very fine Futter Hall organ at the King's School, Parramatta, and a lifelong relationship with organist Keith Asboe, from whom we heard at the beginning of this ceremony, developed. Peter became passionate about the Baroque style of music and the contribution that organs made in the early music revival. And armed with this knowledge, he became interested in making harpsichords, and he actually made seven of those instruments, as Keith told us earlier. But organs remained Peter's first love. Peter carried out numerous restorations and rebuilds of old organs throughout New South Wales, from Mossman here in Sydney, to Armidale, Carcor, Bathurst, and Kangaroo Valley. The biggest and most impressive of Peter's restorations was the magnificent Sydney Town Hall organ, a massive undertaking. It took his firm 10 years to restore, from 1972 to 1982. It was during this time that Peter's marriage to Barbara broke down. As was too often the case in those days, the children went with their mother, deprived of contact with their father, a situation which weighed heavily on Peter, but he felt powerless to remedy. Happily, his son Michael took up contact with his father as he got older. During this time, Peter was approached by Bill Mallinson, with whom he had worked at Nodes. Peter had a great fondness for old Bill, as he called him, and took him on to help with the town hall. As the restoration got underway, Peter felt that the team could do with some extra knowledge and skills. Portuguese organ restorer Manuel da Costa responded to the call. Manuel moved his family, including his wife Esther, and his children Betty, Maria, and Rui Felipe, to Australia. He made a great contribution to the Pogson firm, and continued the restoration of the Sydney Town Hall organ when Peter relinquished that position. Manuel was a loyal and productive employee whom Peter held in the highest regard, and a brother relationship developed between the two men over the years. Manuel was a loyal and productive employee. Oh, I've said that already. But just to labour the point. Now, it was through this circle of friends that Peter met his second wife at a dinner party at the Sydney home of organist Robert Good. 15 years his junior, this woman was no subservient little wifey, but the product of second wave feminism, even feistier than Peter was himself, with big opinions and not afraid to share them. Her name was Narelle Nelson. Peter was extremely fortunate to meet Narelle, because a little bit like the organ itself, Peter was very handsome on the inside, on the outside, but there's an awful lot going on the inside which the public don't see. He was, Excuse me, he was a complex and sometimes troubled man. But Norell understood his passion for organs and music and was brave enough to take on the life of an organ maker's wife, which is not necessarily a recipe for comfort and ease. Peter and Norell married in 1978, and they had two daughters in quick succession, Rachel and Elizabeth. With increasing rents in Sydney and a lack of suitable space to erect organs, Peter relocated his business and his young family to Orange in New South Wales Central Tablelands in 1983. At this time, Peter was approached by a Japanese organ builder, Tamisuke Sawa, who was interested in working with Peter and giving his family a better life in Australia. Tamisuke, or Peter as he was known in Australia, came with his wife Kumiko and their four boys, Isamu, Makoto, Nozamu, and Jun. They moved to Orange and the family became very much part of the community, with Kumiko playing the harpsichord and teaching Suzuki piano to hundreds of students. Australia has become musically richer for the contribution of both the Da Costa and Sawa families, who came from Portugal and Japan to work for Peter Pogson. The organ manufactory in Orange was Peter's dream workspace. It was originally part of the old Dalton Flour Mill in Paisley Street. A three-storey cavernous brick building, it was perfect for both his new builds and his restorations. But it was bitterly cold in winter and impossible to heat. Peter used to go to work wearing numerous layers of clothing to make it bearable. The first new organ to come out of that building was for the Sutherland Catholic Church, and a recital was possible to play on the instrument before it was transported to Sutherland. This concert saw organist Peter Kneeshaw perform with the local Roland Gregory Orpheus Choir as part of an Orange Festival of the Arts, and the town was abuzz. They'd never seen or heard anything like it. Today it wouldn't pass health and safety muster, as the guests had to sit on organ pipes and packing crates among the machinery. Peter and his team built 27 organs in total, a substantial legacy to the musical life of Australia. Many of us have heard or seen his organs without knowing it, at the Melbourne Hall in Melbourne University, the main hall at the University of Queensland, or in the Futter Hall or the chapel at the King's School in Parramatta. The musicians among us have performed alongside Peter's instruments on many occasions. Peter also made an organ in Ishikawa Prefecture in Japan, on which local organists remarked that they thought only German organ builders made instruments of such quality. The Orange music scene had started to develop with the help of a musician in residence and the relocation of violinist and violist John Gould. The Orange Symphony Orchestra was born, and as interest developed, more specialised music tuition became available. Peter's daughters, Rachel and Lizzie, became budding string players, and this gave Peter another interest in maintaining their instruments, sometimes against their will, and building new ones. Rachel and Lizzie played in the local ensembles and orchestras, and Peter was kept busy helping cart percussion instruments in the trusty pogo van to various rehearsal venues on Saturday afternoons. He felt, and was, very needed, as were many of the parents involved in that development at the time, without whom it would have failed. Holidays for the family consisted of tuning trips throughout New South Wales, not always to be greatly appreciated by the family. Norell would often take a book along to stop falling asleep over the keyboard, waiting for Peter to adjust the pipe. There was probably only one person alive who thought that holding keys for an organ tuner was the best job in the world, and that was the late Clive Gunning. Peter built Clive a two-manual organ for his home in Katoomba, but with the sudden deaths of Clive and his wife Margaret in Scotland in a car accident, Clive's Pogson-built organ was donated to the Presbyterian Church in Orange. Peter felt that this was the best instrument he ever made. At the time Peter moved his business to Orange, he was operating two factories with 10 staff, with a view to eventually closing down the factory in Guildford. He was very happy in this new central tablelands environment of Orange, at a distance from the destructive politics of the Sydney organ fraternity at the time. The cultural cringe was alive and well, as churches and institutions seeking new instruments tended to overlook Australian organ builders. Surviving during those times was difficult. Interest rates had skyrocketed. Peter was not able to demand the prices that overseas builders were charging. So he got by selling each house that he owned to finance the next organ built. The practice of selling the house to pay the staff and commence the next job only stopped when there were no more houses to sell. Working with wood and dust for so many years and the days before safety equipment, it started to take a toll on Peter's health. He became a chronic asthmatic and developed a bronchiectasis, but he soldiered on in his only really happy space, his organ factory. Peter enjoyed some of the really simple things in life, with pies and custard tarts being fairly close to the top of the list. He used to swing past his favourite bakery in Summer Street, Orange, almost every day to partake. For his 70th birthday, his dear friend Mary Turner, OAM, gave him a large card with 70 tiny Australian flags in it. Upon presentation of the flag, Peter could redeem a custard tart at the local Vietnamese bakery. Eventually, Peter had to reduce his workload to tunings and repairs. He retired to Potter in his large shed at the rear of his house, where he built three violins and a viola and maintained many local street instruments. In 2010, Peter and Narelle moved to Newcastle to be closer to Rachel and Narelle's family. Although he grudgingly agreed to move, Peter was determined that he was not going to enjoy being a Novocastrian, although he did take pleasure in the occasional concert and in watching the Newcastle Youth Orchestra's early development, which his daughter Rachel was involved in. Peter's last few years were a struggle. He suffered the first of many strokes in 2012. He lost his motor skills and experienced many chest infections. He wasn't enjoying life. After spending many years in the comfort of his own home, thanks to the selfless compassion and heroic efforts of his wife, Narelle, Peter's needs became too great and his condition too fragile. He spent the last few weeks of his life in care at the Hunter Valley Private Hospital. Peter died peacefully on the 29th of April. His spirit lives on through the family and friends who remember him, and in the magnificent legacy of his organs, the undisputed king of the instruments. Rest in peace, Peter. Day by day, the organ builder in his lonely chamber wrought. Day by day, the soft air trembled to the music of his thought, till at last the work was ended, and no organ voice so grand ever yet had soared responsive to the master's magic hand. Our final musical tributes today will be Dietrich Buchterhude's Prelude Fugue in Chaconne in C major, played by Peter Kneeshaw, followed by the Pogo Players with Respighi's Suite in G for organ and strings, with soloist Peter Guy, conducted by James Goldrick. Afterwards, please join the Pogson family in the atrium for a Pogo pie and a glass of Prosecco. On behalf of the Pogson family, thank you all for coming today.